Good morning. In case you're wondering, Rachel is not here this morning. She's on a well-deserved break. So we're taking advantage of technology, and we have the Hawk family helping us out. Blessed be God, most holy, glorious, and undivided Trinity.
And blessed be God's reign, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. The Lord said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet, and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, Mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impotent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord, whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in Psalm 123. To you I lift up my eyes.
To you in the front of the hands.
As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their masters.
And the eyes of maids to the hand of their mistress.
So our eyes look to the Lord our God.
Until he show us his mercy.
Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy. Too much of the scorn of the indolent rich.
And of the riches of the proud.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. And then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen. Amen.
So this morning, Jesus travels back to his hometown, and we're presented with the story of how his hometown people had difficulty believing in him. In fact, they took offense. So what's that all about? Well, the reaction of Jesus' hometown shouldn't surprise us. I mean, think about it. When someone just like us makes it big, for some reason, rather than rejoice, we tend to dismiss or even tear down. Who does he think he is? What's so special about him? I've known him for so many years and I've never seen this before. Just who does he think he is? And then this story is immediately followed by Jesus sending out the 12 disciples, sending them out two by two. He tells them that if any place does not welcome you and refuses to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet. I think there's a connection. The people in Jesus' hometown refused to hear him, and so he explains to his disciples that if that happens to them, to simply keep on going. Continue spreading the good news. Continue on in ministry. This all seems to be saying something to us about the character of our lives. We do have a choice. Do we have a desire to participate in God's work, to bless and care for creation, or do we resist? Do we not see what's right in front of us? I mean, think about it. Up until now, a dominant feature of all the stories Mark shares with us is the deep desire of those petitioning Jesus to be healed and restored. Yet in this story, all the bystanders can see is a local kid who's made it big, and who from the vantage point of scarcity and insecurity has grown too big for his britches. Trapped in their comparisons and complaints, they're not even remotely interested in receiving his blessing. Even Jesus can't believe it. The truly sad and astonishing thing about this story is that the townspeople's suspicion and resentment diminish Jesus' ability to work good on their behalf. In some mysterious and disturbing way, the people's small-mindedness, their lack of trust, and their inability to embrace a new facet of Jesus' life and mission actually keep them in spiritual poverty. It constrains Jesus. It blocks the healing work he longs to do for the people he loves. Something precious is lost when we fail to recognize the unfamiliar within the familiar. When we turn away from the extraordinary within the ordinary, we miss the presence of God in our midst. According to Mark, it is Jesus' own community, his very own faith community, that fails to recognize the truth of who he is. How, when, and where do we miss out on the sacred because we insist that Jesus speak in the time-worn ways that we think we know best, because we demand that God act in ways that protect our status quo so we look good, because we recoil when God shows up unexpectedly and dares to do a new thing? What will it take to follow Jesus into new and uncomfortable territory, to see him where we least desire to look? In Brené Brown's work, The Gifts of Imperfection, Let Go of Who You Think You're Supposed to Be, Embrace, and Embrace Who You Are, in guidepost number 4, she talks about letting go of scarcity. Addressing scarcity doesn't mean searching for abundance, but rather choosing a mindset of sufficiency. We each have the choice in any setting to step back and let go of the mindset of scarcity. And once we let go of scarcity, we discover the surprising truth of sufficiency. And by sufficiency, I don't mean a quantity of anything. Sufficiency isn't two steps up from poverty or one step short of abundance. It isn't a measure of barely enough or more than enough. Sufficiency isn't an amount at all. It's an experience, a context we generate, a declaration, a knowing that there is enough and that we are enough. Sufficiency resides inside each of us, and we can call it forward. It's a consciousness, an attention, an intentional choosing of the way we think about our circumstances. So faced with that human need or desire to tear someone else down, stop and think. You are enough. Your light is not diminished because someone else's light shines. The call of the gospel is not a call to stand still. It's a call to choose growth over decay, to choose light over darkness. So a question is, how might I refuse to let others in my life grow and change? When do I box them into identities or labels that are narrow and constricting? Where in my life do I silence the unfamiliar instead of leaning into newness with curiosity and delight? Do I allow the people that I'm close to become who God desires them to be? Do I allow myself to become? Or do I cut myself and others off with expectations that are severe and stifling, perfectionistic expectations? Perfectionism is this very addictive belief system that if we live perfect, look perfect, keep it perfect, everything's perfect, that we can avoid or minimize shame, blame, judgment, and criticism. Perfectionism is not about being our best selves. It's a defense mechanism. Brené calls it the 20-ton shield. We carry it around thinking it'll keep us from getting hurt, from feeling judged, feeling shame, feeling criticized. But what it actually does is it keeps us from being seen. And it is so heavy. Jesus sends the disciples out two by two, taking nothing for their journey except a staff. He's telling them that they are sufficient, they are enough. And if they're not welcome somewhere, leave, shake off the dust. Don't carry that heavy burden with you. Shake it off, let it go. The lowly carpenter reveals himself as Lord. The guy with the tainted birth story offers us salvation. The hometown prophet tells us truths we'd rather not hear. We might put limits on his deeds of power, but those limits won't confine Jesus for long. We might amaze him with our unbelief, but he will still call out to us, daring us always to see and experience him anew. From a place of knowing that we are worthy, that we are sufficient, that we are a child of God, we're then able to see God's hand at work in the world. We're able to see Jesus standing in our midst and recognize him, rather than saying, "Who does he think he is?" From a place of worthiness and sufficiency, we're able to be Jesus' hands and feet in this world. But this is a process, one that means focusing on being aware each and every day, practicing the art of gratitude on a regular basis, pushing back on the competitive nature of our world, pushing back on the scarcity narrative of our world. God is present in the very ordinary of our daily lives. Our God is a God of abundance, not scarcity. Jesus is here and now in our hometown. We pray for the vulnerability to see that, to know that, and to experience that. Because life is not a competition. We are all interconnected. So may the light of Jesus in me see the light of Jesus in you, and may the light of Jesus in you see the light of Jesus in me. Amen.
Please stand as you're able as we profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As people of faith, we are called to be prophets. Let us open our hearts and call upon our God, saying, O God, hear our prayer. That our wounded and numbed hearts may be given hope, and that in our weakness we may be empowered by God's guiding hand. Let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. That each of us may open the door to the one who knocks. Let us pray, O God, hear our prayer. That as the sea transforms rock to sand, God may transform our weakness to strength. Let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. That we may be instrumental in alleviating the pains of oppression by reaching out to the poor, the homeless, and the neglected. Let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. that we and all in the church may recognize the prophets in our own midst, let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer, that all in any need, especially those listed who are near to our hearts and those we name silently or out loud. May receive God's mercy, let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. For all who protect and serve, as well as their families, the police, the firefighters, emergency medical personnel, and those serving in the military, especially those listed who are near to our hearts, and those we name silently or out loud. Let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. For those in our parish family celebrating birthdays this week, Scarlett Grubb, James Anderson, and Kathy Terry. And for those celebrating anniversaries this week, John and Susan Petura, let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer. Let us be mindful of the dead, especially Samuel D. and Edna Nealis, for whom the altar flowers are given, that they may come into the fullness of life, united with God in the communion of the faithful. Let us pray, saying, O God, hear our prayer.
Compassionate God, we come to you aware that the prophet within each of us shrinks from your call. Give us the courage to speak and live the word of your Son, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning. Are there announcements before I go on?
Yeah. Somebody on the lawn today, but we're going to do it in the show.
Oh, good. It's hot out. Thank you. Thank you. All right. And actually, while Donna is speaking, how about if I call you up?
Yes.
Come up. So I think many of you know that Donna has retired from teaching in the Coatesville Area School District after 40 years.
And that,
and this is the first Sunday we've both been together here in the sanctuary, so I'd like to offer a prayer on her retirement. Okay. Let us pray. To everything, Lord, you have given a season, calling each thing good in its time. In the years of our lives, you call us to work, you ask us to play, you command us to rest, and by your grace, you weave our days together in peace. We pray for our sister Donna, who comes to the end of her season of work, of teaching in the Coatesville Area School District. Thank you for friends made, challenges met, children encouraged, and growth enjoyed, and for all she has accomplished. Help her now to let the old work go, to take up the new life for which you have also given her gifts, through Christ the worker, in whose love is our eternal rest and joy. Amen.
Amen.
Isn't that, yeah. Yeah, thank you. All right. Any other announcements? Okay, this Thursday at noon, our healing service continues via Zoom. And on Saturday, July 20th, there is a Learning Life Skills Together happening here in our social hall from 12:30 to 1:30. And there is it's a free activity. There's lunch offered afterwards. But it's a program for families learning skills related to emotional regulation. So kids will be doing crafts, and the adults will be working on some skills. So Learning Life Skills Together, July 20th, 12:30, here in our social hall. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, O holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. And on the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And as supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that was Cyril, our patron saint, and all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Alleluia. Be known to us, Lord Jesus, in the breaking of the bread.
Be known to us, Lord Jesus, in the breaking of the bread. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
This morning's anthem, we've chosen in Levi's, number 60, How Great Thou Art. The choir will sing the first two verses, and then we invite the congregation to join us on the fourth verse.
We're skipping three.
Lord my God, when I am awesome wonder, consider all the growth thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great.
Our service continues with the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make this earthly pilgrimage with us. So be swift to love and make haste to do kindness. And the blessing of God, who comes to us as creative force, redeeming presence, and life-giving Spirit, be upon you and all whom you love and pray for this day and forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.